Welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We're here in Cliff's Edge. We found the Stichus right over here, which these guys over here, well, that council member is looking for. Lord, whatever his name is. For some reason, Eretus is new to our party, but he won't come with us. It's terribly... not very practical.
Yes.
23 more shins. Now let's see if we can talk to this thing without fighting it. We're supposed to find out where it is, but I don't think just seeing it counts. Hidden enemy? Is that what it is? Yeah, see. Probably hiding somewhere. So we don't actually know where it is, even though we can see it. So we have to interact with this thing. At least in some manner. Oh, there's eggs there. Proportionally speaking, the creature that laid these eggs must be truly formidable. Did you lay those eggs?
Remember that.
Partially hidden in the trash of the dump is a strange and frightened creature. No, it's kind of standing out in the open. It's covered in chitin like an insect, but its shell looks thin and soft, and its small and malformed claws seem half-grown. It stares at you from its hiding place and chitters incomprehensibly. Okay, so it's really not as dangerous as the councilman made it out to be, but then again the councilman was admitting to us freely that the people of Cliff's Edge need something to fear to bring them together, because they're too soft and, you know, they need conflict and stuff like that. It exudes a sense of sentience as it watches you, but you sense nothing in its mind as though it were a common object. What are you? The creature makes vague motions with its claws and emits a series of clicks and wet guttural noises. Oddly, you smell dust and lightning. Some of the sounds are reminiscent of a human with digestive trouble, but you're fairly certain it's some form of language. How did you get here? It weaves its head and clicks its claws, then pauses as if waiting for a response. The odor of ozone and stale air surrounds you. When you make no reply in its language, it shakes its head vigorously and says nothing more. Where are you from? A series of gurgling sounds emerges from deep inside its belly, punctuating by a concussive grunt, followed by a scent of sparks struck from rocks and metal. It isn't clear whether the Stichus understood you or not. Can you tell me anything about this place? The smell of coal, dust, and rotting metal surrounds you, and it takes you a moment to realize that the Stichus emitted the scent. Something about the creature's behavior is familiar, and you realize that you, or at least the changing god, have spoken to the beast before, not skillfully, but well enough to be understood. Try to remember the language of the Stichus. Alright, I'm using maximum here. Damn it! A murky memory comes to you. You and the Stichus standing over a small device, but what is the device? What is it doing? The memory slips away from you, spinning into the mists of amnesia. Damn it. Requires trained title affinity skill. Trained title affinity skill. Otherwise we could unearth the buried language of the Stichus. Yeah. Are you the rogue Stichus that everyone is looking for? As you speak, you gesture in the direction of the square where you met Lord Vunken. That's his name. And the Stichus seems to understand. It shrinks back, raising its deformed claws as if to defend itself. It doesn't seem like it would be much of a threat to anyone. It puffs a minuscule amount of vapor from the spiracles on its head. I'm not going to attack it. Yeah, that's it. I'm not going to attack the poor thing. Looks like we could manipulate that if we could get over there.
Let's go. go.
Wait.
Updated my journal.
The scrawny boy reaches out to you as you pass. Ma'am, please. Oh, that's the monster thing. Ma'am, please, ma'am. I know you saw the Stitches hiding in the mid. Please don't tell anyone about him, ma'am. He's not doing anyone any harm.
Making a note.
You saw his hands. They're like human hands. He can't dig like the others. It's not him that's bringing down the houses. What's a Stichus? Everyone knows what Stitcha are. They're diggers. They make tunnels under the ground. I don't know. Stitcha and Stichus seem interchangeable. Confusing me. They make tunnels under the ground. People around here think they're the reason the houses are falling down. He looks back toward the alley. Except this one can't dig, so the other ones kicked him out. At least, I think that's what happened. Anyway, he's all alone, like my sisters and I, so we want to help him. Okay. Yeah, I'm not giving up, then. What is this Stitches to you? We found him, ma'am. My sisters and I. And he was so pitiful. Near to starving. Near to dying. We've been feeding him ever since. But we've got to get him out of here. The neighbors will find him soon, and that'll be the end of him. He thinks, he's family. Every bit as much as Nim and Avena. You feed him power cells? Stitcha eat electrical energy, and we can't find nearly enough. He's starving. Do you have a plan to help him escape? No, ma'am. We can't just walk him down the street, or that fat little lord would see him, not to mention the neighbors, and they'd kill him for sure. Don't tell me that guy stands there, like, day and night. I won't tell anyone. Your secret is safe with me. Gold tie, tiny amount. Thank you, ma'am. You're a lifesaver, ma'am. Now, if only we could get him to safety. Maybe I could find a way to get him out of here. Another tiny amount. I wonder if we're going to be gold by the end of this game. Could you, ma'am? That would be wonderful. If you could find the other Stitcha, maybe they'd help him. I heard that some of them were down in the underbelly, but I've never seen them myself. Oh, that'd be awesome. I'll try. Thank you, he smiles. I had a feeling I could trust you. Good fortune to you, ma'am. Let's see if they have anything else to say. I'm glad I could probably, you know, help him. Anything else about the area? Hardly anyone comes through here anymore. It's nice and quiet, I guess. Better than the rest of Cliff's Edge. Just want to see if they have anything to say about Stitcha now that we know. Oh, yeah, yeah. She smiles as you approach. Song today, ma'am? How much? I don't want to part with, 12. How about 8? Play me a sad song. Thank you, ma'am. This one will break your heart.
There we go.
The girl lowers her flute and looks up at you. Do you want me to play another? Oh, yeah. Do you feel the same way Zeb does about the Stitches? The poor thing. We're all taking care of it. The other Stitcha abandoned it, so now it has no family, except us. She leans in. Please don't tell anyone about it. Zeb would die if anything happened to it. Farewell. Alright. So I might talk to this Lord guy again. Yeah, let's go back and talk to him. Let's see if she has anything new to say. I don't know what's up with the rodent. We don't have money to spare.
Fine.
Let's go back to him. I'm not going to tell him about it. Let's see if we have any other options. He smiles as you approach him again. The likely one is back. Have you found the Stichus yet? I'm not telling him at all. Okay. I've learned that you're part Yavoki. Abandon your hunt for the Stichus, or I'll tell the crowd. He hisses at you under his breath. You would use my family's shame against me, you poisonous hypocrite, and I'm sure you think yourself noble for doing it. He swallows. You know they'll kill me if they find out. You really want that on your conscience? I won't have it on my conscience as long as you do as I say and stop hunting the Stichus.
I'll remember that.
See, no gold for that one, but we got indigo a small amount and silver a tiny amount. He lowers his head, furious. Very well, I'll call it off, but this is not the end for us, friend. You will regret crossing me. Lord Vunken turns to the crowd. Citizens, it seems we are making no headway in the hunt for the Stichus, so I am returning home. I suggest that you all do the same. Good luck to you all. He let it get away. I thought we were going to see some blood. Ha! Should have known. So, what else are we doing today? I need a drink. Mob justice? More like mob failure. Blah. Are we all leveled up?
Yes.
Oh, that's an answer to my question. Cool. Oh no, she didn't. Okay, that's not the level up sign then. Venus Dirge. Oh, cool! That's what that is! Plus 5% willpower and intellect tasks for listening to her music. Cool. For her flute playing. I like that. Did my dominant tides change again? So now it's still blue. Cool. Anyway. Let's go in here. I'll go up the stairs after. What is this? There's also this, which is what? Fifth Eye Tavern? Cool. I love this game. This is awesome. Teeth of the Memora! Oh, the Lurica! This guy looks like he's from Mortal Kombat. I was a beggar. Please, gentle heart, look at me. I'm looking. Now what? Interact with this thing. What is this? Don't kick me while I walk past you. These three triangles float serenely above a scuffed stone basin. You can't help notice that the citizens of Stegos are giving this monument a wide berth. Do you have anything to do with the little cube things in the Reef of Fallen Worlds? The largest triangle shines brightly, radiating a soothing warmth. The middle, darker one hovers above it, turns slightly away from the first with what strikes you as disdain. How can a triangle have disdain? The third is a small, dryly amused, and so deeply indigo. The third is small, dryly amused, and so deeply indigo as to be nearly black. It's removed from the first two triangles. I guess that one? You hesitate. You are sensing emotions from these objects. Intent. Something is strange here. Okay. We can touch one. We can study one. We can examine one. Crouch to look at the stone basin. The stone is cracked in places, but far newer than the ancient shapes that float above. You suspect that the citizens of Stegos added the basin to make the triangles look less out of place. Really. Before I touch anything, examine the smallest triangle. The tiny object spins slightly faster than the others. The more you stare at it, the more you sense a glowing presence in the air. The icy regard of distant eyes. You blink, swaying. In the half second before you open your eyes, you hear the thunderous crack of wood on wood and the rumble of distant voices. You snatch your hand from the triangle. Wait, I touched it? I just want to examine it. I didn't thought I was just going to be looking it over. Study the medium-sized triangle. Staring at this triangle is disorienting. Same as this guy. The longer you stare at it, the more you feel a tight, coiling sensation in your own head. Standing on your toes and stretching, you manage to brush the triangle's icy face with your finger. The air thickens like a weight over you, and you struggle to keep your eyes open. Between the thumping of your heartbeat, you hear thousands of purposeful, rhythmic footsteps treading endless stairs toward the peak of a vast, echoing room. Okay. Touch the large triangle. You reach out and time slows. Your hand drifts past individual motes of light dappled dust, moving into the warm glow of the large triangle. Calm warmth bleeds up your arm when you grasp the edge of the triangle. It's somehow rigid and flexible at the same time. Whoa. You blink and a strip of light unwinds ahead of you, like a path through infinite murmuring dark. Behind you is an ever-shifting Z-trope of linked, motionless U's. It is your past, you realize. Every second of it, every choice pouring out of you and trailing away into the black. You open your eyes. You're back at the stone ring, still touching the triangle. All three of them are watching you. You blink again. The strip of light, the surrounding darkness, and in the valley between the slow pulsing of your heart, you hear the murmurs of countless witnesses, the raised voices of your past and future companions, the heated condemnation of enemies you haven't met yet, and above it all, a trio of voices, one warm, one cold, and one dryly practical. They are speaking a verdict, but you can't hear them over the din. Shout for silence so you can hear the judges. Red tide, huh? You bellow into the dark, clenching your fists, and the crowd instantly falls silent. So do the judges. In the echoing silence that follows you, you realize that you are alone. You always were. You stride on. The path unravels before your every step. Your past unspools behind you. Stay on the path to see where it leads. You follow the road. Casually, you look to the right, and the path at your feet flickers, as if anticipating your new direction. Clearly, your choices define this road's course and not the other way around. You open your eyes. The three triangles hang in the air exactly as they did before, unmoving and silent. The vision is gone, and yet you can still feel the choices you've made, curving away behind you like a string of jewels. You straighten, moving into the future, breath by breath. Blue tide again. You suddenly notice a message carved into the stone ring beneath the triangles. Judge yourself. As you watch, it slowly fades away. Huh. What if happens if we touch the large triangle again? Soothing warmth creeps up your forearm. You find it hard to focus on the questions that trouble you. What about the medium-sized one? It spins, seeming to pull your thoughts along with it. And the smallest? It spins on, and this time, the presence you sensed is gone. Huh. Teeth of the Memora. The three triangles hang motionless and silent in the air. Now they're moving. Tormented Levy. Well, let's talk to this guy. Johnny Cage or whatever the hell. Aidan Sitabo. This large, muscled man is practicing some form of martial art as you look on. He is wearing an old, white, rough-woven coat with the sleeves torn off, and a red bandana is tight. Sorry guys, I don't know why I can't speak all of a sudden. And a red bandana is wrapped tightly around his head. He seems to be moving much faster than his size suggests is possible. He glides between stances as swiftly as water. His fists are blurring hammers, striking at invisible enemies. His bare, callous feet snap and slash at the air like knives. Where'd you learn to fight like that? By challenging the deadliest creatures and studying their killing blows, he says. I lack claws or teeth, But I do the best I can. By studying the killing blows of my enemies and taking them for my own. You're very fast. Yes, Aidan says. The Drebel's gift! His hand slips around an invisible assailant's arm. He snaps it with a stab of his elbow, then crushes his enemy's throat and flips him over his shoulder to the ground. Chrysanthema Ray, he shouts, spinning over the invisible adversary's corpse to deliver a triangle of jabs to the chest of the next attacker. The entire set of moves took no longer than 4 seconds. He catches you, staring, and smiles. You must be wondering why I'm shouting. Yes. I'm not surprised. I must look like a lunatic, he says, before spearing his opponent's jugular with 3 fingers. Canted thrust! It helps me focus my breathing, my strength and will. It reminds me of how weak I once was, and how strong I've become. Years ago, I was a starving beggar. I managed to steal a wedge of pie crust and was terrified that someone else would take it from me, so I hid inside the metal structure over there to enjoy my feast. Bite of the hidden queb, he says, clawing his enemy's eyes. The stale crust crumbled into pieces between my eager fingers, and something strange happened. They drifted toward the ground like the softest of snowflakes. I was able to pluck each of them from the air before they fell. At first I was delighted. Then I wept. How far had I fallen? How far had I fallen? That clean food was a miracle. He delivers 4 more blows to the air's belly. But the miracle never ended. The longer I lived in that shelter, the more I could slow the world by concentrating. I swore to never waste this gift. I would honor it by becoming stronger, faster. I would challenge the predators of the world and take their killing blows from them. I would never be prey again. Crush stomp! How are you so fast again? I could slow time around myself at will, and I never stopped training. Have you seen a 10-year-old girl with dark curly hair?
Making a note.
Yes, he says, bowing his head. I've seen her crawling out of a fissure in one of the collapsed houses in this district. She's likely hiding, but I did not pry into her affairs. Hiding in a fissure in one of the collapsed houses in the district. I bet I'm faster than you. What do we get? Silver? You're not the first to think so, he says casually, snapping an assailant's neck. I should warn you that all the others are dead. That's not a threat. I only fight to the death. He flings the invisible corpse aside. Before I accept your challenge, I'll need to see if you're good enough to face me. His fist lashes toward you. Julius kiss. A slow punch. First. He thinks. Some challengers are braggarts, but they don't deserve death. I'm not going to fight him. Flinch. He pulls the punch and lets it fall. There's no shame in knowing your limitations, he says. Farewell. I don't feel like fighting him. Finzin. Surgical drone? Oh, we got like a hospital or something here. Cool. We're interacting with this thing. This silent and ancient machine casts a long shadow. As you study it, your breath shudders in your chest and your hands shake. You can't help feeling as though you have stood in this exact spot before. Examine. A jumble of mismatched parts make up this once functional generator. You notice a familiar circinate symbol etched into the metal like a maker's mark. Alright, let's take care of that. Finzin? Got loot here. I want the loot.
Yes, now.
Now, loot now, baby. Yeah, 29 shins, right? Yep. Cool. How much do we have now? 234. Let's talk to him first. This Levy is not like the others you've seen. The wide smile is absent, and his oddly shaped eyes are red, wet, and haunted. He stares past you, whispering to himself and turning a small, charred object over and over in his hands. Don't worry, guys. I'm going to talk to Finzin, whatever his name is. Greetings, he says, apparently by reflex. He still hasn't looked your way. How? How can I help you? He closes his eyes hard, as if trying to crush visions that are troubling him. Despite that, his mind feels like a complete blank to you. What are you holding there? I'm... He says, then grimaces, as though his words hurt him. I'm holding my shame. His hands unfold one bloody soot-covered finger at a time. A crudely made wooden bird lies there, painted in pinks and pale blues and charred around the edges. That bird represents your shame? Represents? No. This is my shame, and I'm holding it. He swallows. I can't put it down. It is shame, and it is mine. What's wrong with you? I'm wrong, the Levy agrees, his lips trembling. Rotten, made of the wrong pieces and tied together with blackened wire. He covers his face with his wrists. Please go. I want to talk to you about someone. Yes, he says, then shakes his head. No, I can't. Find another Levy. Please. I can't report crimes to you? Crime? He says, as if he's never heard the word. No, please. No. I need directions. I can't. I can't help you. I'm wrong. He pauses, lifting his eyes to the sky. I'm lost.
You're lost?
Yes. No. I know where I am. He squeezes his eyes shut. I know everywhere I've been.
All right, no more options.
He shudders. Hopefully that something comes of that. This dilapidated structure has been converted into a cheap boarding house. Inside, people sprawl on filthy mattresses in a dimly lit room.
Go.
I still have to go over there, too. This house was reduced to rubble when part of the cliff face collapsed. There is evidence that squatters have slept here recently. A ragged blanket, rotted fruit, peelings, and footprints in the dust itself. Something scratches deep within the rubble. It sounds like someone or something is in there. Hello? The rubble makes no response. Dig deeper. Ooh, we're zooming in. You crawl partway inside, pushing aside boards and a thin slab of slate. A small girl gasps, throwing up a hand to block the sudden light. She's young. No more than... Is this Rhin? No more than 10 or 11 years old. She has made herself as small as possible to fit inside a tiny gap in the rubble. Her hair is dark and curly. She pulls herself deeper into the rubble, away from you. Why are you hiding in there? She puts a finger to her lips, then tries to shoo you away. You hear a voice behind you. I told you patience would pay off, lads. What? Some thugs stroll over. They all carry weapons at their sides, though they walk with the cocky assurance of those who don't expect to need them. Uh-oh. Hooded thug says, I swear I checked this hovel, says one of them. She wasn't here. No one was. How did this draft find her so easily? He gestures dismissively in your direction. Don't fret it, Bega. The thief looks you up and down, then calls out in the direction of the rebel. Come on, little bird. Doesn't matter how good you are hiding. You have to come out sometime. New! It is Rhin. The girl huddles behind you, keeping you between her and the thugs. Even so, it's obvious she's not sure about you either.
Don't let them take me, please!
Yeah, they're thugs. I'm not gonna ask her that. Why were you looking for her? The little urchin ran away from her home. Her mother asked us to find her and bring her back safely. To the girl, is that true? No, she grabs your wrist. They're bad men. They want to steal me. Kidnappers. Now that's just crude. The man crosses his arms. We're delivery men, that's all. The means and motivations of our employers ain't none of our business. Dropping his facade, he turns to you with a look that pleads for understanding. But, all right, yeah, there is a slaver who'll put up a fine bounty if we bring her back. It's all legal, and none of your business. Best just stay out of it.
He says the words kindly enough, but his colleagues' hands are on their weapons. He thinks, it's not like I want to work for slavers, but jobs are scarce as it is. You can't take me. Her grip on her wrist, your wrist tightens. She found me. She has a discoverer's right. Yeah, I want to avoid a fight, guys, but I'm not going to let them take her. No way. The hooded thug raises an eyebrow, a bemused smirk playing on his face. Is that so? Well, Spider-Jack, what do you say? Is she coming with us? Or are we taking her from you? Spider-Jack. Intimidation, persuasion, or deception. Not taking five, no way, no how. One, I'm afraid, would, fail because we're not using anything. I mean, who knows? This might just be the win-all. What are we better at? Persuasion or deception? I think... I'm pretty sure we have a minus one in deception. I don't think persuasion. I might not be remembering it right. The guy's already thinks he's already not pleased for, you know, happy about working for a slaver. So I'm gonna try persuasion. Because of whatever he's thinking. It doesn't matter if it's legal. Slavery is evil, and you're a part of it. Boom. All the way up. Damn it.